Hi, this is Officer Klein with Customs and Border Protection, Anchorage, Alaska. Just checking to see where you're at. We were expecting you 3.5 hours ago, and just checking to see if we need to call out the emergency services or anything. Get this message, give us a call. Thanks, bye.
And he was a young boy. I'm going to say somewhere around 5 to 6, as I recall. I remember he would sit in here and watch television during the whatever Gulf War that was, and the fighters taking off from the aircrafts. And
fly safely. And make sure you're not too high. I'd rather have you land halfway down and stop.
On his 14th birthday, he was so accomplished a pilot that I had no qualms about it. I mean, he could have soloed months before that. Legally, he couldn't, but in terms of skill level, he definitely could. My concern again was that no matter where he went, he was going to be surprised by weather.
Jack Wiegand is not your typical 20-year-old. It's safe to say the Bullard High grad has loftier goals than most people his age.
Starting May 1st, I'm going to attempt to be the youngest person to solo an airplane around the world.
Yeah, you heard him right. In a little more than 2 weeks, Jack is hoping to soar his way into the Guinness Book of World Records.
If I'm back before my 21st birthday on June 22nd, then I will have the record when I am 20 years old.
With 600 flight hours already under his belt, Jack is a veteran in the cockpit. Jack says his parents are supportive of his record-breaking mission, even if it means he'll spend 40 to 50 days flying around the world by himself.
It's one of those times when you think, oh gosh, did I do the right thing? Should I have let him do this? Because anything can happen up there. We were all pretty emotional when he left, just waving goodbye. I'll never forget that.
On May 2nd, Wiegand takes off from his home in Fresno, California. His route, 21,000 nautical miles over 12 countries and 3 oceans. Jack makes his first international crossing in Canada, where customs personnel greet him warmly. They know his story, but Wiegand forgets his passport in the copier back home. The oversight gains him an international fan base where CNN and others run the story. He will forever be known as the boy who left his passport. Miles from the Iran-Pakistan border, a plane begins to tail Jack, an unmarked F-18 with unknown intentions. Because Jack's AM radio doesn't work, he cannot follow protocol to identify himself using the international frequency. His fate is in the hands of the fighter pilot. Eventually, the F-18 peels away.
I guess I was as surprised as anyone when that jet intercepted him, because I don't know where it came from, and I don't think Jack knew where it came from either.
20 miles outside of Calcutta, India, Jack's GPS shows lightning. His fuel is minimal. He must continue. Above the airport, Jack spots a small patch of clear sky within the thunderclouds. He shoots his plane into the opening. He throttles back the engine, throws the flaps up, lowers the landing gear for more drag. He then makes a series of tight circles within the opening. Slowly, he lowers the plane below the clouds. At the small airport, a ground crew watches in disbelief. Calcutta landing challenges every piloting skill Jack has, but his biggest test is yet to come. With a bum radio and a plane that is burning too much fuel, Jack must cross the Pacific to land in the Aleutian Islands at night. The islands have more aviation fatalities than anywhere in America by 3 times.
The only time of his trip where he was going to be faced with 2,000 miles of open ocean. There are no islands at all between the island of Hokkaido and the Aleutian Islands, which is where he was headed.
This frustration level was
escalating every day when he couldn't leave, as my fear was what he was getting into. We always were trying to get somewhere else.
And I was a little bit hesitant, but it looked to me like his only chance to go was the fact that the system coming out of the sea at Athask was slow enough so that it wasn't going to block his route. And then we had this other system coming up from the North Pacific that was not going to be getting in his way.
No more than 10 seconds after I took off, I was over water. And that was kind of where I was going to be living for the next 12 hours.
And probably more than 30 minutes into the flight, he talked to me on the telephone and said he was running into snow and some icing, and it looked like he was running into weather. And at that point in time, it sounded like he wanted to turn around and come back. But I'm looking at the weather screen on my computer, and I'm saying to him, Jack, I think you should go with it, stay on that heading you've got, and I think you'll get through it.
This is what the sunrise looks like over the North Pacific Ocean. I'll show you the position where I am right now. You can see I'm more than halfway. This is the Kamchatka Peninsula. You go west here. This is Japan, where I came from. And I am crossing over the middle of nowhere right now in the ocean. You can see as you zoom in, I'm getting closer to the Aleutian Island chain right here. This is convincing because if I have to, from Karto, I can always divert to Shemya, Alaska. But if everything looks good, which it does right now, knock on wood, I can go all the way to Adak.
It was a situation where he had just enough time to get between them, and because the two systems were rotating opposite one another, they provided a huge tailwind through this very narrow channel between the two systems, enough for him to launch himself through there.
I really went right in between two very large storm systems, you know. Had I gone through any one of those storm systems, it could have been a much worse outcome.
Without a tailwind, he would have been forced to land through the fog in Attu, and that would have been really, really dangerous.
I knew that, okay, because I had these tailwinds that allowed me to go further, I have to take advantage of it, and I have to go on to Dutch Harbor. So I took another 3 hours and was able to make it to Dutch Harbor. I got to Dutch Harbor with, you know, only about 14 gallons of fuel left in the tank. You know, the plane holds 130. You talk about only having 14 gallons left. That's not very much. 14 gallons of fuel probably would have lasted me around an hour. But an hour to go where, you know?
Right.
Dutch Harbor was the only airport within a few hundred miles that had avgas, the kind of gas that I needed.
To me, that was by far the scariest part of the entire flight.
You know, 58 or 59 days later, it was, you know, it's kind of just backing up in my mind, you know. Yes, having bad weather to land in St. Louis, he told me, the passport issue, you know, the issues he had in India that he touched on a little bit, being intersected by the fighter F-18 or 15, whatever it was, over the Gulf was... You know, he's going to make it. He's going to get this done.
During the entire flight, I would always kind of envision what it would be like to come back to Fresno.
I'm about 15 minutes outside of Fresno. Feels good to be back in the valley. Feels good to be getting close to home. I'll turn the video back on when I land. Check it out.
I turn in, I see two fire trucks, and I knew exactly what that was for right when I saw them, but I thought, wow, this is, you know, such an honor to have this happen. So I was just ecstatic to be back, ecstatic to see everyone, so happy to just kind of be home again. It was definitely worth it, but it was only worth it because I was successful with it. It was worth it because it's done, and I don't have to do it every single day, but would I do it again? Probably not, no time soon at least.